Good evening, everyone. I'm absolutely delighted to be able to welcome you all here this evening to the London College of Fashion and to this sort of launch event for the art in polarised times. I think we will all agree that it couldn't be more timely than to have the event that we've got on this evening. And I know that we've got a great set of speakers. Obviously, speaking from a college like London College of Fashion, where essentially the majority of our students are female, at a time when so many women are, in a way, being polarised with the sorts of debates that are going on amongst Trump, and in a week where we have International Women's Day, I'm absolutely delighted to be hosting this event. So thank you very much, everybody, for coming. And I'd now like to introduce Nigel Carrington, Vice-Chancellor of the University of the Arts, London, who will say more about the research fortnight.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. And can I add my welcome to Francis's welcome to this college and to the start of something that's very, very important to UAL as a whole, and that's our research fortnight. It's a very important event in our research calendar because it brings together academic staff, PhD students, and other staff who are deeply engaged in our research agenda. And it's important partly because in such a large and dispersed university, it's sometimes hard for us to bring together people from different disciplines, from different perspectives, and give them an opportunity to think about the great challenges that we as a university debate and discuss every day. So welcome to Research Fortnight. For those of you who are part of UAL, you've got the full program on the university's intranet. For those of you who are from outside UAL, many of our events are in fact open to the public, and we very much hope you'll join us. You'll find the list of public events on our UAL website. So that brings me to the debate itself, and I think it's fair to say that there's probably nobody in this room who doesn't find the events of the last year or two deeply disturbing, and I think for most of us they are really disturbing events. But they're also an opportunity for us to talk more fervently and in greater depth about our views, to not only to put our perspective on what's happening, to think about how our disciplines are affected by what's happening in the outside changing world, but also how we can make a difference. And for that reason, I'm really delighted that we have such a distinguished panel with us tonight. Welcome to this debate and discussion. And I'm absolutely delighted that Professor Jeremy Till, our Pro Vice-Chancellor for Research and the head of Central St. Martin's, is chairing the debate. Many of you academics researchers will know Jeremy as a leading academic in the field of architecture, particularly interested in issues of scarcity and creativity. But many of you, whether you've seen him here or on the steps of St. Paul's, will know that he's also a passionate commentator, critic of what happens in our society and how important the values which we espouse and the issues which we debate are to solving our problems. So I'd like to welcome Jeremy to lead what I hope will be a very exciting discussion and to carry us through the rest of the evening and to introduce our distinguished panel in more detail. But thank you for being with us. I hope you really enjoy the evening and that this leads to your engagement in the rest of our research fortnight. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Nigel. Right, we're all going to stay sitting. Just to remind you that the symposium, the event this evening is called Art in Polarised Times, and I think it's fantastic that the UAL Professoriate took the initiative to say we need to be doing this, that we need to be putting our hands up and saying, what does it mean to be an artist, a designer, and a university of creativity in these polarized times? And boy, are they polarized, that each new tweet from Trump, each new pronouncement from a hard Brexiteer, each new announcement of austerity regimes, and so on and so forth, just accentuate division. They polarize us even more. And I think for many people, there's a sense of almost helplessness, particularly in the hysteric execution of power over truth that we're seeing on both sides of the Atlantic. I recently wrote an article in relation to what architects might do, and there I used Anthony Giddens to identify four potential reactions. The first is that of sustained optimism. It's all going to be okay. Boris says it's all going to be okay. And, you know, he's got a jolly nice way of saying it, because we all feel, well, we don't actually feel that good when he says it, but he keeps on saying it anyway. The second is cynical pessimism, which is basically my Twitter feed, as much as people seem both with a black humor looking at the world but not knowing how to change it. The third, which I think is the most dangerous, is pragmatic acceptance, that we feel that, okay, it's going to happen anyway, so we'll just do the best that we can, and we will duck and dive. And an institution like this, to some extent, needs to pragmatically accept it, otherwise we will go under. We need to be looking at what we can do for our EU students, etc. But the fourth reaction that Giddens identifies is that of radical engagement. And possibly radical engagement for me is the most, well, not only possibly, it is probably exactly the way in which an institution like this, as a set of individuals but also collectively, should take on some of these issues. Not to retreat, not to pragmatically accept, but to open up new spaces. And I think that art and design has a fantastically important role to play in this. In as much as I guess that most of the people who voted for Trump and Brexit already feel betrayed, in as much as they were promised a new form of politics, but in fact what we've been given is an accentuation of the old form in a more corrupted method. And therefore, where are the new narratives going to come from? Where are the new hopes going to come from? Where can you actually find spaces in which you can speculate in a generous and open manner? Where can one find the execution of creativity which depends on borderless exchanges? And I hope that some of those questions we will address, the five fantastic speakers, but also the audience, as we go through the evening. So I always feel it very strange to introduce people when everyone's got their biographies. So I will do it from memory, and then all the gaps can be done by reading it. So our first, and they've very generously said they're only going to speak for 3 minutes. I can tell you that's more generous than saying I will speak for 15 minutes. We might allow you a bit of slack. So I haven't got a bell, which we do at CSM. There's a gong, and it's gonged off stage. But each speaker will give a short response to the theme of art in polarized times, and then we will have a collective discussion. And then we will open it up to the what looks like a very distinguished audience as well, because I think that this needs to be a collective response, and that's why everyone's in the room. So first off is Johanna Sumuvuori, who is the head of society and culture at the Finnish Institute, which is just up the road in King's Cross in St. Martin's, and so are close neighbours. And rather scarily, Johanna is enrolled as a postgraduate student at St. Martin's, so it's going okay. But before that, she was a member of the Green League in Finland, was elected as a member of parliament, as well as being a long-standing city councillor and active in a whole set of social agencies. So over to you.
Thank you, Jeremy, and thank you for inviting me to this event. I was so happy because as Jeremy said, I'm head of society and culture. So I kind of, in my work, I combine society, scientific research, and I use culture quite often as means to get to my aim, and combine also different kind of people to have interactions between scientific and artist and cultural world. I don't go into details. I would like you to Google Finnish Institute in London and see all the activities we have, because I don't want to do this. I don't want to use this as a promotional event, but I tell something about my work because it resonates with this topic tonight. My topics are generally my main themes I work for are equality and diversity, education, and open democracy. And I have one slogan which I stole from Patti Smith, which I have kind of used as an umbrella slogan for all these activities, and it's culture has the power. What we have done with this slogan, last year we recognized, actually that happened before, it happened already, it started to happen after 2013 in Finland when the True Finns won election, and the True Finns being a sister party for the UKIP party here. And after that, it was quite noticeable how racism, open racism, increased and became more visible in Finland. And actually what we organized then, I didn't even work at the Finnish Institute at the time, we organized together with certain amount of cultural activists, frontline cultural activists from Finland, a huge demonstration, We Have a Dream. We called it We Have a Dream. And we gathered almost like 20,000 people to the citizens market. And they were like, all those artists were performing for free and appealing for racism-free Finland. After that, I came to London and I started to work with my program. And I read The Observer and recognized there was one article about rock against racism movement in the UK. And then I was like, oh my God, this is exactly the same what we did, but it was okay a lot later and in Finland. And of course, the scale in Finland is a little bit different because we are a country of 5 million people, which is less than people are in London. So you can scale that. But I invited the photographer, Steve Shelton, to our office, and we decided to bring this exhibition to Finland because it's really timely. So we organized Rock Against Race. We brought that exhibition to Finland. That's just an example of how we want to approach certain things. We want to use art, be it music, be it photography, be it whatever, like performances or so. And by that, I don't mean that we want to politicize art, because for us, art is free. It has to have this freedom, and it has to become from the artist. We don't want to, you know, steer society in a way that some committees would decide what kind of art is legal in the country, or, you know, what kind of art can get funding in a country. But what we want to do is that if we recognize social movements within art circles, we want to encourage them and support them and be more visible and probably activate other similar kind of activist movements as well. It's a pity you don't have this screen on anymore, because there was, I don't know if you saw this picture of Mauno Kiini too. That is one example of what we are doing here in London now. At Southbank Centre, there's going to be a Women of the World Festival, actually this weekend. And we're going to have a run at the Finnish programme there as well. And we are bringing the art collective called Nutty Tarts, which is, consists of two women who make socially engaging artworks. And they created Mauno Kiini, which is, unlike bikini, it has only one strap here. And it was designed for women who have actually suffered from breast cancer. But their aim was not only to raise awareness of breast cancer, their aim was to tackle this kind of pressure we women face and encounter every day. Those insane beauty ideals, insane pressure from commercial world, and they created an art project. And they have had fashion shows with Mauno Kiini models proudly presenting their bodies as a piece of artwork to the audiences. And that has actually been acknowledged worldwide. They have gained a lot of press attention from different countries. And third thing, I probably have used my 3 minutes, sorry. The third thing we want to encourage is culture jamming, which is artistic ways of critically commenting commercial products and products of mass media. And we have organized discussion where we have engaged like British and Finnish artists who use culture jamming as their ways and means of engaging in a society, but also doing art and networking. So those are just, you know, like batches of realm of what I'm working in. And I hope that you feel encouraged that if you're working in this field, whether be it science or art, that you can do these kind of things and comment the world in this way. So that's basically what we do. And you can find more information on our Facebook page or Twitter or webpage.
Thank you.
Finstit UK.
Robert, I think you are next. So Robert Eaglestone, who's Professor of Contemporary Literature and Thought at Royal Holloway University of London, whose best known work is looking at the Holocaust and using postmodern perspectives to interrogate the Holocaust, as well as being a committed teacher and lots of other things. So, Robert.
Thank you very much again. Thank you for inviting me. Well, that's a bit boomy. Is that a bit too boomy? Down a bit. We're living in polarized times. In 3 minutes, I thought I'd say that the reason times are polarized, I think, is because of what they call the populism, the new populism. Populism is quite a hard thing to define. So here are some characteristics of it to explain our polarized times. Traditionally, political parties represent particular or sectional interests, whereas populists claim to trump all that because they represent the people or the will of the people over interests. So they claim to be beyond political parties, and so they claim to be beyond politics. Okay, beyond political interests and beyond politics. And that's one of the reasons that why politicians and political systems have such a hard time dealing with them. And indeed, sometimes why they have such a hard time dealing with political systems. Contemporary populism, interestingly, combines the traditional left-leaning supporters often in working class communities who feel left behind or abandoned or impacted negatively by globalization, with the sort of traditional right-leaning supporters who hate openness and liberalism. Populism hates, as we know, immigration, globalization, international alliances like the European Union. The elites, for the left populists, hate the wealthy. Right populists hate metropolitan liberals and political correctness. Although I think we know that populism of the left is not as powerful as populism of the right. Populism is bad for minorities, very bad for the rule of law, because if you're speaking for the people, you don't need to claim to deal with the law. Populism hates the status quo. Status quo is how things are. Populism loves national identity, authoritarian and messianic figures, and at the moment is supported by powerful media interests, which are also anti-political because they are primarily commercial. Okay, so commerce is often anti-political. And they're also being helped by what I was trying to think about as by the digital media. Okay, they're not being helped necessarily by Twitter, they're being helped by the uncertain outcomes of what happens with digital media. We don't not quite know how Twitter works or what happens. Okay, so the uncertainty has helped them. But this populism is cultural as much as it's economic or anything else. And if it's cultural, that means that clearly you get to be involved with art and culture in the broader sense. So what is the role of art in this? Now, the problem with asking that question means it begs the question like, well, what is art? Okay? And the trouble with that question is that after about 3,000 years, we still have no idea at all what art actually is. Okay? So it's everything about what art is. I think a little bit about what art does and how that might relate to some of the things I just outlined very briefly. Okay? I love your thing about culture has the power. That's really, really good. Okay, so one thing art does is propaganda. Okay? And if art is propaganda, you choose your side and deploy, as they say. Okay? But the trouble with art being propaganda is that it works both ways, or works for every different sides. I mean, those amazing Soviet art pictures on display now are also covering up, you know, intentional famines and political murder and so on. Okay? It's also interesting in terms of populism that art is always seen in in the hands of the, as an elite thing. It's really interesting about Trump and UKIP. We're very happy with the Tory, or not happy, we understand exactly that the Tories quote Shakespeare, this sceptred isle and blah, 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 blah. And we know that the right wing manipulate news culture in that kind of way. But it's interesting that UKIP totally don't. Paul Nuttall or Farage never quote Shakespeare because Shakespeare is elite and they're anti-elite. That's really interesting. And similarly with Trump, if a normal Republican had been elected, you'd have found all sorts of country, both kinds, country and Western, playing at the inauguration. But in fact, he couldn't get anyone to play. There's a really interesting thing about art and culture and propaganda, okay? And similarly, in relation to art, propaganda, art as a tool, we have to watch out for what Adorno called something like the poison at the heart of all art, which is kitsch. Okay, so kitsch is like art's internal anti-art, okay? So that's one thing art does. Another thing art does, quite famously, you ask me a question about it later, okay, is about healing, okay? So sometimes art is used as a healing thing. I was very struck, I was watching with my daughter Adele at Glastonbury, and she played a set, and she mentioned, oh, we're all very upset by what happened yesterday or on Thursday, and the audience booed. And she said, oh, no, it's all come together, and they carried on booing. And I thought that was really interesting, because she couldn't, even though she was Adele at the Pyramid Stage, she couldn't make things come together. A failure of art. Another thing art does, which is important, like for my line of work, I guess, is using art for education. Okay? Art is a way of opening into things, understanding things. Art's a thing you can teach with. Sometimes people say art's like the residue of thought, the residue of creativity you can do things with. But all these things, propaganda, kitsch, healing, and educating, all use art as a tool. And one of the things that you said I thought was really, I agree with, is that art is sort of free. Art is not a tool. Art is its own thing. It's sort of world-making. I've written here in my notes, art opens, which is very sort of cliched. But and if I had more time, I'd try something really elegant. But what I want to try and say is that one of the divisions between the new populists and the other forms is that it's not a clear left and right kind of thing, okay? People talk about it being about openness versus closedness, okay? Closed-mindedness. So it's there's unlimitedness versus limitedness, okay? There's definition, or there's things that are undefined, hard to define, like art, 3,000 years, we still don't know what it is, hard to define, versus what literally is defined, delimited, sort of fences put up. Stuff that's free versus stuff that's contained. And it seems to me, although we still don't know what art is, there's something about it that is free and uncontained and boundless, which seems to run against the grain of lots of those things that make up the new populism and so are polarized times. Thank you.
Thank you. Next up is Sonia Boyce, who many of you will know as chair in black art at UAL. I read lots of resumes of Sonia and felt exhausted by the end because I'm not quite sure how she keeps it all going, because she's not only leading a huge research project here at UAL and Middlesex about black artists and modernism, which is, I think, a really significant piece of research. But also, I guess some of you would have been to the ICA to see her most recent show, We Move in Her Way. She was elected a Royal Academician in 2016, et cetera, et cetera. So, Sonia, over to you.
No pressure. And it's been really, really very interesting. Thank you, by the way, for the invitation to be part of this conversation tonight. And it's been really interesting hearing the comments that have been made already. I don't have a prepared speech. I was just going to wing it a bit. And I suppose one of the things I was going to kind of start off by saying is that I can't remember a time when I've experienced so much talking about the political situation that we're in. I mean, literally on a daily basis, every day I seem to have a conversation with somebody about whether it's about Brexit, whether it's about Trump, whether it's about refugees, whether it's about, you know, it just seems like there's this constant wave. And part of me wonders whether One, we're obviously trying to figure something out in this moment, but also whether we're actually trying to do something in our talking with each other, which I think is a really, you know, that's my positive spin, you might say, on it. I mean, I've got, you know, there are many things that one can kind of go into, but I suppose the point of our coming together today is to think about how this might affect what we make and how we make, and whether there's a direct correlation between what's going on in the world and what we might be doing in our particular cultural spheres. And it's not easy to make that direct a relationship. Having said that, though, one of the recurring tropes particularly within art schools, since I've been going to art schools, for a very, very long time, is that there's a suggestion that there's a split between art, which we read as aesthetics, and politics, and that somehow the rightful art practice only thinks about aesthetics, and political art somehow exists somewhere else. And I think this is one of the things that, of course, it doesn't ring true in terms of what people have been trying to do in their practices. And, you know, there are many, many examples, whether at UAL or many art schools up and down the country, where people are trying to figure out how they speak not only their own particular truth, but the context of their truth. And so I would beg, really, for a kind of flip, maybe, to take place, where we don't see that as a split, as a polarised thing, that actually, of course, art is and always has been quite a political activity. But what is most important for us right now is how we talk to each other about that. Very finally, in terms of the kind of political realm, there are two really interesting exhibitions that are on at the moment, one of which I'm in, which is a show that's on at Nottingham Contemporary called The Place Is Here, which looks at the emergence of a black art movement from the late 1970s and into the 80s. And what's really exhilarating and also troubling about that show, it's a big survey show, is that a lot of the works feel like they are very fresh, that they're speaking about now. And so it makes me really kind of disheartened when there was a sense in which we thought we'd had a tacit agreement that we were beyond certain kinds of questions and certain kinds of issues, that they've risen very abruptly to the surface again. And then there's another exhibition that's here in London at Raven Row, which is called This Way Out of England, which is looking at, again, at the 70s, looking at certain kinds of kind of conceptual, formalist, participatory, radical art practices of the 70s. And the title just seems so intriguing, This Way Out of England. And I think it's really prescient, really, for us to be thinking about those things.
Thank you, Sonia. Next up is William Raban, who, again, many of you will know. He's a professor of film at London College of Communication. Was educated at St. Martin's, and then in the 70s made a really seminal series of movies, of films, which I think, I hope that people know. I haven't seen that many, but there's one, is it The Balfron Tower, which you make it?
Yes, that's right. It's a film called About Now, MMX, which sort of comes back to your point, Sonia, about art being for the present moment. Yeah, sorry, I interrupted you.
Over to you.
Thank you, Jeremy. Thank you. And thanks to everyone who's gone before. I mean, I think some of the ideas that have been raised are really wonderful. And I hope I can do this little presentation justice. I'm actually going to show a film. So I'm going to do a much shorter introduction, because the film is 2 minutes, 20 seconds. So I reckon that gives me 40 seconds. About which I've used maybe 15, 20. So this is a little film I made in April last year because I was very angry. I was very angry at the way in which the referendum debate was being conducted. I never thought, to be honest with you, that it would go the way that it did, though part of me feared that it might do. And so I made this film as, and it comes back to something that Rob was saying earlier. I mean, you said, Rob, I think, I mean, you were musing on what is art for, which I thought was very interesting, artist propaganda being one idea. Well, I suppose I made this piece as art, as, if I can call it art, a provocation, which is slightly different. So this is, I see this this little film as a satirical fairy tale, and it's the only film I've ever made which I've made freely available on Vimeo and YouTube, because I kind of depend a little bit on film rentals from my distributor. So if you make things freely available, that's sort of screwing your rentals up. But I just wanted to do this. I wanted to do this almost as a gestural piece and to see what would happen. So if we could have the lights down, please, and you could play the film.
Once the Queen had been removed to Windsor, Buckingham Palace became a homeless centre. In fine weather, the Royal Gardens offered further sanctuary. By 24th of June, with the count nearly over, it was clear that all of England except London had voted to leave the EU. Scotland and London voted substantially to remain. The constitutional crisis of a divided nation lasted until September, when the Greater London Assembly approved legislation to make London an independent republic committed to remaining in Europe. The Glassstone building of London City Hall by Tower Bridge became the Republican seat of government, whilst the old Houses of Parliament accommodated refugees and migrants. The Republic was defined within the perimeter of the M25. The old country became the happy home of little Englanders who doted on their monarchy and enjoyed their ancient customs. Londoners appreciated their newfound freedoms and self-governance. They were pleased to be rid of the old pageantry, the Lord Mayor's show, and trooping the colour. The divorce was surprisingly amicable, with England being given total control of the armed and security services. London saw no need for a Ministry of Defence and was pleased to be shot of the Trident nuclear deterrent. Like the Queen, the former Tory government was removed to England, and Boris Johnson tried to lead his fractured party from his new constituency in Witney, deep in rural Oxfordshire.
Well, let's just hope that people from outside London didn't say, we'll leave you to it and vote for Brexit. Okay. And our last speaker is Gilane Tawadros, who is Executive Director of DAX, who is, you will know, is the organisation who protect artists in terms of their visual rights and copyrights and stuff like that. But before that, and importantly, was founding director of INIVA, the Institute of International Visual Arts, which is still a very influential arts agency and archive in terms of broadening the international scope of the visual arts. And that was chaired by Stuart Hall, and Gilane is now also the vice chair of the Stuart Hall Foundation. And we did a thing with Stuart Hall Foundation, Isaac Julian at UAL last year. And also has been a curator of many important shows. So, Jane.
I loved Europe Up London. I think I went through all the four phases that Jeremy described. And when I got to the last phase, I got comfort from living in the Republic of London. And I think quite a few people started talking about the Republic of London. So thank you for making it a reality on screen, in any case. So thinking about art and echoing, about how to respond to this changed landscape, I started thinking about, well, how do we actually calibrate how the landscape has changed? And are we really sure that things have changed? And if so, how have they changed? And are we all sitting here really with a sense of foreboding and therefore assuming that things have changed unquestionably for the worse? So my personal view is that the changes have been taking place to... somebody was talking earlier about a train going in one direction until the train tracks, I think it was you, Francis, until somebody did something and the train was going in a different direction. I think that train we were on was the settled post-war consensus and liberal order that was moving in a certain direction. But I think things have been changing for months, for years, and even decades. I think the sense of urgency and foreboding for some people, and for others, it's eager anticipation, comes from a rapid unfolding of events, which are the effects of gradual incremental changes. And I started creating this timeline in my head, trying to understand when these changes started. And everyone will have, I think, a different timeline. So I started the shootings in Orlando and the assassination of Joe Cox MP and the Brexit referendum, then the election of Trump. Then I started thinking, well, maybe it started earlier. Well, when? Was it the election of Tony Blair? Was it the Iraq War? Was it the introduction of student fees? Was it 7/7? Was it the fall of Lehman Brothers? Was it the shooting of Mark Duggan and the London riots in 2011? Was it the emergence of UKIP and other extreme nationalist parties in Europe? But as soon as I started to plot the timeline, I remember something else that has happened. And so my timeline keeps extending backwards in time. Then I dispense with timelines. I forget about trigger points. I ignore root causes, specific geographies or locations. And I hover like a hummingbird, trying to extract the sap, get to the essence of what is different now and what that difference means. I think it's sort of symptomatic of the times we live that everything has to be condensed, abbreviated, reduced to fit a short attention span, or the 140 characters of a tweet. I'm quite a wordy person by nature. I like words. Probably because English isn't my first language, I revel in making full sentences. But I thought that I would use my 3-minute, 180-second slot, rapidly diminishing, to address the question of what's changed. And it's worked for US presidents, so here we go. So what's changed? The private sector is revered. The public sector is reviled. Ideology has been racialized. Post has given way to alt. Postmodern, post-colonial, post-capital has given way to alternative for Germany party, alternative right, alternative truth. Cosmopolitanism has come to be equated with elitism. Multiculturalism is out. National corporatism is in. Religion has retrenched. Culture has been sold off. Education is instrumentalized. Art is commodified. Both are transacted globally. Demagogues have become risk takers. Artists have become the new conservatives. Maybe. So how should we respond? By expanding our vision, by being bold and taking risks, by insisting on difference, by celebrating the public sphere and its productive potential, by stimulating the creation of more artists and intellectuals, by insisting on art's necessity, by doing what artists do best, which is imagining a different future.
Thank you.
So I'm going to try to start the conversation and then hand it over. And my first question to you all is to pick up on something Robert said, which is he went through that great list and then said, but these are all tools and art isn't a tool. Art is free, uncontained and boundless.
And I wonder whether that is going to be enough as a response. That I'm very much aware of artists' antipathy to be described in any way as instrumental or to be described as a set of tools for change. But I wonder whether the urgency of the present condition actually asks us to reconsider not necessarily the instrumental nature of art, but art in, as some of you said, an expanded way which might have agency beyond the individual. So I'm going to ask you that question first, Robert, since you provoked it.
Artist first.
Hmm?
Ask an artist first. Well, I just say again what I think I said is that art is a very boundless kind of thing, and I hear what you say about political art and aesthetic art and so on, and I'm not sure I'd want to police a sort of difference, but if it's used politically, that's of course it's art. I totally agree, but it's still doing something with it. It's still being a sort of tool. And the thing about tools is they can break or not work or do things in different sorts of ways. And so I'm not saying one shouldn't do it, but I think it's a very effective tool for doing things with. But I mean, you have to know when you're doing it, that is what you're doing. I mean, does that sound, I feel very antsy because I write essays and books.
Sonia, what would your response be to the sort of...
In a way, we've got so much history that we have to kind of deal with in terms of prescriptions for art. Is it functional? Is it non-functional? Is it political? Is it not political? You know, does it do things in the world? And what is it that it does in the world? That it's really very... It feels one can't go into that conversation in a kind of unknowing way. So there's no way I can say to anybody in this room or to myself, art needs to be like this or be done in this way. Mm-hmm. And to a certain extent, it requires a degree of trust that somehow one of the big questions for artists is that we're there to solve some kind of amorphous problem. We are problem solvers, but it's in a way it's a question of, well, what actually is the problem? How do we articulate what the problem is at the moment? And in that sense, we need others. We need these other kinds of conversations to then be in dialogue with. But I can't be prescriptive about what art is should or shouldn't be doing. I just think it's a very dangerous road almost. We've been down that road before. Mm. It's a very dangerous road. And so it's like, what do we do in this? I don't have an answer. But I'm hoping with other people we might find one or find some ways of moving through this.
William.
Yes, I just wanted I was very taken with what you said before about trying to demolish that supposed separation between politics and art. And I think there might be another way of looking at this. Jean-Luc Godard said very famously, the problem is not how to make political films, but how to make films politically. And we could take out film and maybe think more generally in terms of art and apply that same idea. So that it becomes about the whole mode of production, be it art or be it filmmaking, be it writing, rather than just a so-called a message or content of the work in itself.
But I find it very difficult to know where those boundaries are.
Yeah. Mm. But they're not.
Or that is not already taking place and has been taking place. The question is how we then start to have those dialogues where we see the nature of the political mode in which something is being made, the context it's being made in, the effect it might have in a given. At the moment, I'm kind of thinking of I always forget his name. He did the seven walks and the trail of green paint.
Alice.
Francis Alice. You know, and for me, that is such a, you know, such a strategic work that resonates way beyond its materiality. It's all about its context and what it does in that space and how we then think about that particular kind of action. But that's not something that you can prescribe for everybody to do at the same time. And I'm not sure that we want to say to, I'm sure everybody who's come to this wants to find ways in which they can operate and strategically think through this moment, but one can't send that out as a kind of
But to get back to Robert's first point about populism and the way that the populism has taken a whole group of people away from what many of the things that we revere, whether it's an exhibition of the Tate, how do we... We can all go on about that fantastic piece. I think it's an amazing piece, but that, in a way, just reinforces our bubble. Mm. So how do we use art as a means to address the people who would sneer at that bubble?
Yeah, can I continue? Yeah, actually, I would like to address what you just said as well, and it actually resonates with this one as well. So talking about political art is dangerous in a way because it's labeling art, which I wouldn't like to do. I wouldn't like to put any labels myself to any piece of art or artistic work and kind of like ordering certain kind of art from the world. So, but what I'm concerned about is that usually when the going gets tough in the society, like political reality becomes really dangerous or is in turmoil in general, I think the art is somehow, it tends to be the last resort of freedom in a way. And when that freedom is disrupted, it becomes political. You know, it's what I try to say is that I'm not talking about political art in a way that, or engaging politically in terms of that you should make your work as political, but I think that artistic circles or people who are engaged in art world should be cautious about what's happening in the society because those developments are undermining their freedoms as well. And that is something that, which is really hard to explain, but or to elaborate, but I hope you understood.
Mm-hmm. I think it's a really difficult problem. I mean, the moment we're in now, some people have referenced back the 30s, and yet, you know, and Robert knows more about this than I do, but, you know, totalitarian regimes, the art that was most threatening and disruptive was art that was avant-garde and difficult and indigestible. So I think we have to be wary about the idea that, you know, in a sense, we start to instrumentalize art as soon as we start even to call it free. I mean, what happened, you know, with abstract expressionism, that was used in a very determined way to speak about American freedoms in antithesis to, you know, what was going on in the Soviet Union. So I feel uncomfortable, and I think, you know, art is not like science. It's not. It doesn't pose a question and then look for an answer. You know, I think that's the frustration in talking about research, isn't it? And in terms of artistic practice, that often an artist will begin research and end up with 30 questions and not answer any. But that's what we need, isn't it? Isn't it this precisely what this moment requires? Because everyone is coming up with easy answers and simplifying things to such a level that they become not just mundane, but unquestionable.
Let's open up to the audience for questions. With one rule that questions have a question mark at the end.
Well, I want to ask William a question about political film and return his question to him, because it's a good point to make that we have to make films politically. And one person I think of here is Sieberberg and Hitler, a film from Germany. Now, that's a man with quite dubious politics, but he made a very good point in that film, which was to say that as far as he was concerned, Hitler had broken his connection with Germany, and that gave him the right as an artist to freely invent everything. Invent Hitler, in fact. So in some ways he was saying, if you have taken this away from me, I will return it in spades. So is there a way we can do that? Well, you have, in a way you have done, but are there more ways we can do that through film or through other means?
That's a really interesting question, and I haven't got an easy answer, I'm sorry. But it did make me think that there's a kind of filmmaking practice happening at the moment which is very much concerned within the essay film, let's say. I don't want to sort of break film down too generically. But this kind of mixing of fiction and documentary, which I think film can do extremely well. We've actually got a screening on Wednesday night for the Screen Research Forum at LCC, but of a film by Louis Henderson, which does precisely this blending of, or fictionalization of fact.
Yeah. One in the front.
I think this could be a question for anyone, really. You talked, it rises out of Robert's point about populism, because I think in a way we've been talking very much about the artist and whether the artist can view themselves as instrumental. We've talked about art as a tool, but we haven't talked at all, really, except I think Jeremy mentioned it a bit with the idea of the bubble, about audiences and about a sort of co-creation of meaning within art. And I'd just like someone to say a little bit more about that, because isn't that part of our problem at the moment, that people don't know who they're speaking to any longer? Picks up on what Sonia said as well. Who is the audience? What is our relationship with that audience?
I think it's a key question. So Sonia, given that a lot of your work deals with co-creation and a kind of expanded field, how do you think because I think the theme of the evening is that things have changed, that there is an urgency, and therefore how do we as an art institution and individual artists respond to that?
Earlier today I was doing a little bit of what Gilane had presented in terms of thinking back a bit, thinking back to Rock Against Racism, or thinking back to when I was a young socialist and going out selling newspapers, particularly during the miners' strike, and thinking back to very particular kinds of political stroke cultural activism. And I think that or the way that I'm reading the situation at the moment is the infrastructure for those things have shifted enormously. So, you know, for me, it's no surprise that we're having this conversation in academia, because I think that this is where we were pressed to. The public sphere has dwarfed. So in terms of trying to talk about a much more contextual dialogue, one has to think about, well, where are the infrastructures for those dialogues to take place? Do I make sense when you say that?
Johanna, what about you? I mean, in terms of your role as Finch Institute is to look for new audiences and to talk to new audiences. Are you going to adjust the balance of your program in order to reach the people who obviously haven't been reached?
Of course, but that's kind of like this interesting thing in this question, because we were talking about how art should be free, and so, but if art is truly free, you shouldn't be too much, you know, concerned about the audiences, because then if you start to think about the audiences too much, then you start to direct the way you do things. And that is just a reality with everybody who is working with art institutions and writing funding applications and doing art. That's a word, definition for that. Audience profiling or targeting, mm-hmm. audience, mm-hmm. something. I just studied it. And I think it's like getting away from this idea that you just, you know, find whatever art, which should be in theory free. But is it really free ever? Like, if you think of the funding structures and everything, and as a former, I used to be chair spokesperson for the Helsinki Cultural and Library Committee, and we were actually handing out those little funding munches for artists and cultural people, and that was actually the way, the moment when I started to think of it, the whole structure of the culture, and it comes also to the educational institutions and the art colleges, but it also comes to primary schooling and so how do we, you know, steer or culturally or politically manage those institutions? It has a huge impact on how you see what can be done and how audiences or whatever are actually encountered. So I would like to, I don't know, expand probably this discussion a bit to more structural way as well. And when we're talking about populist movement, I know that this goes a bit far from the actual topic, but I can't be without mentioning education and equality, because, and media awareness and how to media education, because if you have kids who you know, grow up in a class society and they don't, you know, they'll never get similar kind of chances than certain other kids in some different kind of areas. How can you think that they wouldn't think that certain thing is elitist when they never had, or their parents never had an access to that kind of things? So I think it's not only about how we in this kind of bubble, where we all are probably in middle class, kind of like academic bubble. I think the question is wider, to be honest. So we should dig deeper.
I mean, I have a huge problem with this idea of art as freedom, but because I think that as soon as you say that, then artists can abrogate their societal responsibility, and without wishing to kind of sort of stereotype what goes on in a place like Central St. Martin's, where there are artists and there are designers, that certainly when I teach architecture, I always teach architecture through the lens of the architect's social responsibility. And now I think, so that's where I have a problem with this idea of art as a form of sort of individual freedom. That sounds to me like too much like a sort of a Victorian myth of the muse of genius. Yes.
Thank you. Thanks for some fantastic comments. My mind's really swirling with a number of the things said, and I just want to ask a question related to Jeremy's last observation. And it's got me thinking about what you think if we can't say art is connected with propaganda or openness, or there's a spectrum around which we move, then is there something in the nature of the practice of making? And all of you either make things or write about the process of making or lobby for the spaces in which that can happen. Is there something about the ethics of making that offers a way of engaging what might otherwise be polarized, or is becoming, shall we say, more and more polarized, the title of this thing, Art in Polarized Times? Would that then embrace an ability to explore the social alongside the different gods which every artist and maker serves, of individual freedom, intention, if you like, with social responsibility? And I'm thinking of a slogan around the 80s and the work that I was looking at the Nottingham Contemporary that Sonia's referenced, and how alarmingly resonant those things are, which was the slogan at that time, every text a context. So you make your thing, but it has life in a particular context. So I guess that's my question. Sorry for rambling. How do you see that tension between serving these different gods work out in your own practice at this time?
William.
Oh, I thought that was a question for you, Sonia. I think it's a great question, Britta.
Well, you could frame it very directly into the 2:20 film that you showed us, and why you felt the urgency to make that film, because that you must have done it in a more urgent manner than some of your previous work.
It's very, very different than anything I've done before in every respect. I mean, choosing to put it on Vimeo being probably the least obvious. I mean, I made it out of raw anger. Actually, there's something that I don't say about the piece. because I think one of the speakers, I can't remember who it was, raised the dreadful shooting of Joe Cox during the campaign. And her boat is actually in shot, but the film was shot before she was killed. So I find that quite poignant. I'm sorry, Pratap, I haven't done justice at all to your question.
I think there is, can I say something in response to what you're saying? Because I think this links to what something Johanna was saying too. I think there is a question about the spaces in which art is made and how art is presented and the interface between the making and the seeing and experiencing and participating. And I think that that's something we can attend to. I mean, to take an example, one of my favorite architects, Cedric Price, one of the pieces he made, I mean, he had an idea of an art institution that would only exist for 10 years because that would be the end of its life. And when he put in a proposal for Tate Modern, the original Tate Modern, and he proposed creating a great big glass structure that we placed on top of it and people would be invited to think about it for a while rather than build anything. And he had a whole series of, I think they were called magnets, of connecting. Mm. Rather than have separate buildings or building anything new, that you could create structures that would connect one building to another. And these interconnecting, you know, structures, you know, create all sorts, you know, the possibilities of that in a city are so exciting and suddenly open up all these possibilities of negotiating difference, of moving through space in different ways. And I think one of the things we do need to address is this question of space and how, in a sense, the space for showing and exhibiting work has changed. And it's changed for a number of reasons. It's changed because of the pressures on institutions to get funding. The shift in the balance of funding for institutions between private and public. All of these things change the nature of the interface between the artist and the audience or audiences. And that's where I think there is space for social change and a kind of radical engagement, is at that interface. It's not necessarily that the art has to change. It's the way in which we talk about the art, we present the art. That needs to change.
Yeah, exactly, yes.
And the way it gets circulated.
And the way it gets circulated.
Yeah. It'd be great if we had some student voice as well. And students don't have to... You can just say whatever you... You don't have to have a question. I'll let you off the question mark bit. Just to position yourself and your work and where how you think it's going to change you as an art student in this new time, because it's come up fast.
Hi, I'm Jennifer. I'm studying my MA in Dramatic Writing at Central St. Martin's, and I also did my BA there in Fine Art. So I've got quite a few friends who also graduated from that BA. And we are finding ways to have space. I think there are still spaces. They're not necessarily easy to find, but people do find them. I think it's more about the political problem. That being disengaged, I think, has become quite normal. And I think it takes people making work, young people making work, which people can engage with, which doesn't sort of feel like something that seems too keen or something. It's a problem, I think, the cool thing at the moment, being cool on politics. And I think part of that is also that... there aren't really that many role models who seem to be gentle about stuff and kind of calm.
Role models.
So my question would be, in your work as an educator, how do you see the examples that are being given by the teachers when they're under so much pressure, you know, to do the marking and everything as something to sort of inspire people? Is it I'm sure that there has to be a halfway mark. I'm sure it's that you have to be solving problems as educators, and then that can, I think, help students.
I mean,
there was a picture of Gramsci that came up in the circulating thing. And Gramsci, you know, had this huge argument about why Latin and Greek should continue to be taught, this tussle with Mussolini's government about it. And I think one of the things we do need to fight against is the instrumentalization of education. Mm. I think that that's been a creeping pressure, every level of education, and it's about closing down possibilities. I think that idea, I mean, Latin and Greek have no practical value. You know, how can you make an argument for them? You know, if they are elitist, but at the same time, they're about thinking and therefore thinking in a kind of abstract way, in a way that has no end goal as such. And I think that would be a radical way to start thinking again about education.
I've been very influenced by an educationist called Paulo Freire, who wrote a book called Pedagogy of the Oppressed. I read it when I was doing my PhD, and it blew me away. It's an amazing book. And I could talk about it for hours, but very briefly, the core bit of it is he says that education is traditionally what he calls like a banking model, where the teacher deposits information in the head of the students. That's the way it works. And the students just, you know, and in that, there's a whole culture and structure is created. And in fact, he said education must be a dialogue between equals. Mm. And so even though, of course, there are matters of skill and expertise that people will have, underneath that, education is supposed to be a dialogue between people who, in that dialogue, create a shared world together. So I guess when I try and teach, I try and teach in a way which isn't about here are names and dates and blah, 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 depositing knowledge, but trying to have conversations that create and shape and share a world together. And I don't know how that applies for working other sorts of things. But
that's why. So you're making a plea for a dialogical approach in teaching and working with students in that way.
Which
I totally agree with. Yeah, I mean, it's obvious. And maybe we're very lucky in some ways at University of the Arts that the shape of our subjects and the way they get taught lends itself to that kind of dialogic approach.
Quickly
comment. I'm not a teacher, but I'm a student again. And I was like thinking this, you talked about role models and so, and interaction and so. I read an article about reverse mentoring, which I found really interesting. It resonated with the companies, like how companies use younger generations to mentor them, like young generation of workers, they are mentoring the bosses and other way around. So maybe in education, that could be something as well, because it tends to be that younger generations are more, I don't know, wise in social media or, you know, in technical appearance or whatever. Like they have knowledge what the older generation don't. I think that could actually create something new also in art schools and in all educational institutes, so that they would actually get those ideas which actually are quite often are developing in the grassroots and not halting them just because there are some like status differences between people who are engaged with the institution.
Sonia.
I know there was someone who's been waiting for ages.
Yes, right at the back there. Yeah.
This person as well here.
Hi, I'm actually visiting from New York from SVA's Masters of Fashion Photography program. And so being an American and watching Trump's rise to power, two themes became abundantly clear to me. One of them being that a majority of Trump supporters, I think it can easily be said, voted due to a climate of isolation and living in areas where there isn't much interaction with people of other cultures or other ideas, and that this isolation tends to breed fear. And the second theme being inability to properly communicate with people with different ideas and how via social media or news media that we often either talk past each other or are talking into some type of echo chamber where we are continuing to discuss with people who just reflect our same ideas. So in what way do you envision art as being capable of breaking down these issues of isolation and communication, and going to what you're just talking about with discussion and education, how can we bring that a little bit further to have art not just speak to people who are interested in art, but be able to open up new ways of communicating very serious and grave issues with people who are either like on the other side of the country or have completely different experiences that shape their worldview?
It's such a good question. I think you should answer it. Do you have a, no, seriously, do what normally when you have a good question, there's an answer behind it.
One of the ways that I've at least started to approach it in my own work is to have a more narrative-driven approach to the way I create images. And rather than having an image that stands alone as something beautiful, try to have that beauty attract someone to look at it and then delve deeper into a story and have that story be something that's either unusual or often overlooked. So narrative, I mean, is incredibly difficult to get right, especially in a single image. So as photography, it can either be incredibly useful or really difficult to hit the nail right on the head. But I'm sure that there are plenty of other ways, too, that we can even use new media, new social media, and other ways of using technology to reach broader audiences and engage on a totally different level.
Sonia.
I feel a bit like the grit and the ointment here, but within the art school, my experience of art schools over the past 30-odd years is that there are still quite endemic problems about how the curriculum deals with difference. And so even though we're talking in a wider sense about politics and the social change that we've seen and the things that have resurfaced, in the art school itself, in this art school, in many art schools up and down the country, the question about how difference is actually dealt with within the learning experience, I still think needs to be addressed.
Yeah.
At the same time, I have an enormous love for the experience of the art school and have experienced many tremendous ways, actually, in which experimentation and all kinds of ideas coming from students as well as from staff from in that space of dialogue, but still there sits in the center of where we're sitting, this question about how is difference dealt with, how is difference supported within this context as well as further afield.
So. But presumably that to address the question, that also means understanding the difference of the people who felt isolated, of the people who felt different, disenfranchised, as well as the differences that we've been working on in terms of gender and race and sexuality.
Can I just hazard, I think this is something in a way, like Sonia, I've been thinking back, you know, about the sort of the moment when multiculturalism emerged and the sense and how it began to sort of get disentangled so rapidly and then became a sort of weapon. But I think the question about that you're raising about how you negotiate difference is partly a question about translation, but it's also a question about that difference can't, dealing with difference is not like being an amoeba. It doesn't mean you just kind of take it into yourself. Dealing with difference actually means something else. It means that you have to step down from a position of authority. It means that you have to make yourself vulnerable. It means that you have to identify a deficit in yourself, which is why it is so very, very difficult to do, and why migrants and immigrants are put into the position where they are compelled to do it, because who would really do it if they didn't have to? Because it's really hard, and because it's like pulling the rug from under yourself. And then the other point is about translation, which is that translation is never perfect. It has imperfection built into it. So when I'm trying to communicate to you in a language that isn't mine, that's translated, you must be aware, and I must be aware, that there are all these things that I'm not able to communicate. I can't communicate the context. I can't fully understand your context. There are words, there are nuances, there are intonations that you can't hear and I can't communicate. And it's in that gap, really, where the work has to be done and can never be resolved. So it's hugely frustrating.
Another one at the back, yeah.
Hello. So I just have a question. It's just a general one for everybody. It's kind of to do with my area of research, so any thoughts would be wonderful. The thing I wrote was, I feel what exacerbates the plight of art in polarised times is the power of social media in a populist climate. And I was wondering if you had any thoughts about that. Especially just because I find social media quite a hard thing to look into as an artist, just because of the form that it is. How do you manifest that as an art thing?
Who's active in social media?
I am.
Yeah?
Yeah,
that's a really hard question, to be honest, because we just discussed before this event started, we discussed about this Cambridge analyst.
Analysis,
yeah, this research or study or project they made with this compiling of big data and use it actually for the Trump campaign. And so, you know, studying how masses behave in social media, and that was quite a dangerous thing. So social media and how we behave and interact in internet is it might also be divisive and lead to that kind of processes. But that having been said, I still believe that it has a powerful way of conveying thoughts and giving access to different kind of people. And I think what I'm concerned about is not whether people can use or are able to use social media. I'm concerned about the language, and I'm not talking about my Finglish or English or actual languages. I'm talking about cultural language. I'm talking about restricted cultural code, or on the other hand, wide cultural code, which we don't share, we all of us, you know. Like there might be, I was talking about kids who are not probably from privileged backgrounds. There was even Illich, I think he was an educational scientist who invented or launched this term of restricted code, linguistic code. So kids who are not coming from the families who read or are culturally aware, their vocabulary and their ability to understand certain kind of academic or abstract thinking is not that good compared to the kids who are, you know, raised in academic families and are really, you know, knowledgeable with these kind of codes. So I would be rather interested in how we crack those codes. And it's something what you said that there's this gap that we don't, you know, we can't face each other or interact because I would say that those codes are too far away and there should be ways how to get access to more people or how to get access to these different worlds.
Any other...
Well, one of the things I think about social media apart from that no one knows what's going to happen with it, it's an eruption into the political world. In the political world, you say something and you take responsibility for it. And in social media, you can say whatever you like, and you take no responsibility for it. And it's an eruption of what Hannah Arendt would call all the social into the political. And it's a really strange unbalancing of how our general political public sphere works. And I think we haven't quite got our heads around quite how damaging that is.
My response would be subvert the hell out of it. We got a show on at St. Martin's, which was a response to this, in an urgent manner. And there's a piece in it, I forget what it's called, where if you tweet to the address certain words, then it goes into an algorithm and they cut up Trump's speeches and he will speak your words. It's very nice because they're playing with the whole thing of Trump tweets and videos and back again. And that for me is a good example of how art students are actually working in a subversive but also transformational way. Any other burning questions? One more and then we will...
Sonia's been trying to make a point, sorry.
Well, not a fully thought through point, but I... Nick Mertzoff, who's visual theories, cultural theorist, has recently, in his recent book, How to See the World, talked about the fact that there are over a trillion selfies now. And it's really, it's been kind of bugging me, this. Not that I think, I mean, I'm kind of, I vacillate between that's really interesting, that's really awful. But I think somehow that poses an enormous question for those of us in the visual arts. You know, the question of a kind of super democratization of the image, what does that mean for us? Mm. Also, the very question about being able to represent yourself in the world, even if it's in the digital realm, and how obviously important that is to a vast number of people. How important is the image? You know, what is it about the image, the self-image, that I think we also have to take up these questions in, and not act as if it's business as usual. These are posing very interesting questions for us.
Okay, one last question.
We haven't talked much about what we do as artists, do, and we talk about what we want to do to other people and how we'd like other people to respond, but actually reflecting on our process, I think the word vulnerability was used, and I think that's a really powerful place to be, and segueing into what you've just said, Sonia, and how to help the public that feels disenfranchised to see themselves as artists, because art is transformative, and we are an educational institution. And how do we help the general public to feel truly empowered by creating art in a very broad sense?
I think we'll end on that. Do you want a response?
I think
it's a thing to ponder on, rather than, unless anyone has a direct response to that. It seems an important point to make, yeah. Sonia.
No. It wasn't an answer to this. I'm just really curious about why people have come to this. Why, you know, it's a full room. I'm really intrigued as to why people, you know, what's been the impulse to come.
We're going to get a member of the audience to answer that question on behalf of everyone else in the room. No pressure.
No, I'm not going to answer it. Hello. I'm not from the world of arts. I'm in the political world. I do international reconciliation. And the reason I came here is because I was actually wondering, we use arts to bridge between two conflicting communities. And I was very interested in finding out what you experts thought about the bridging power of arts. And in fact, you said last question, but I was going to ask the burning question in me was, are the artists also polarized? And if there are there dialogues happening across London or anywhere in the UK? And could that happen? Thank you.
That's an interesting one.
Any answers to that? Any answers from the room about whether artists in the room feel polarized from each other?
Perhaps one response is just to say that this week I work at London College of Fashion, and we have staff and students from Paris College of Art and School of Visual Arts, New York. And I think, you know, continuing to have that kind of dialogue and building those bridges between our respective institutions is really important.
Yeah. Okay, on that optimistic note, we will draw to an end. Which way? Which way are we going, that way?